Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today for our audition technique workshop with Q Smith and Lawrence Stallings. My name is Taylor Wyatt, and I'm the education coordinator at Omaha Performing Arts. Just a reminder, throughout the workshop, you are more than welcome to ask questions in the Q&A section to the right of your screen. And if you have any questions, comments, or anything, you can go ahead and publish them in there. And now I will go ahead and I will introduce Q and Lawrence.
Q, take yourself off mute real quick.
Hi,
you take two.
How are you?
Thank you so much for having us. We are so excited to be here to host this digital workshop through the Nebraska High School Theater Academy, and we're so happy that you all are here with us during this workshop, but we cannot wait for you to be back at the Holland Performing Arts Center as well as the Orpheum Theater.
Absolutely.
Thank you for having us.
Let's get started.
Yeah, let's get started.
Let's jump right into it.
Awesome. Let's have our student participants introduce themselves. So if you could say your name, where you went to high school, where you go to college, or if you graduated college, and the pieces that you will be performing today. So let's start with Aubrey.
Hi, everyone. My name is Aubrey Aldag, and I went to Lincoln Southwest High School, and I'll be graduating from University of Nebraska High School in June. And then this fall, I will be attending Roosevelt University's Chicago College of Performing Arts as a musical theater dance major. And today I'll be performing Still Hurting from the last 5 years. And the Dear Baby monologue from Waitress's You Matter to Me.
Awesome.
Great. Now let's go ahead and introduce Nadia.
Hi, I'm Nadia Rashan, and I am from Omaha, Nebraska. I went to Omaha Burke High School, and I am a rising junior. Today's my last day of school at the University of Nebraska Lincoln. At the Johnny Carson School of Theater and Film, majoring in theater performance with a minor in psychology. And today I will be performing a Casca from Julius Caesar, as well as Out Here on My Own from Fame.
Awesome.
Nice.
All right, let's go ahead and introduce Jimmy.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jimmy Gwynn. I'm from Bellevue, Nebraska. I went to Bellevue West High School and graduated in 2017. And I currently go to Doane University right now. And the pieces I'll be performing today are Larger Than Life from My Favorite Year and Edgar's Monologue from King Lear.
Wonderful.
All right. How about Brandon?
Hello, my name is Brandon Evans. I graduated from Miller West High School, and I'm now a sophomore at the University of Nebraska Lincoln Theater Performance. And I'll be performing Fabulous Baby from Sister Act and I Hate the Bus as a monologue from, my
Carol Weathers.
Carol Weathers. Sorry.
Yeah.
That's okay. It's okay.
All right.
All right, and Elliot.
Hi, my name is Elliot Purdy, and I'll be graduating from North Platte High School in, well, supposed soon. We graduate at some point, and I'm also graduating from Mid Plains Community College with my Associate's of Science degree, and I'm going to UNL in the fall on a track scholarship, and I'll be majoring in construction management and architecture.
Awesome. Awesome. I love that.
That's great. All right, Q and Lawrence, do you have anything that you would like to say to the students or the student participants before they get started, or should we just go ahead and get started?
No, let's say a couple of words for them. First of all, thanks y'all for being so brave and courageous to be out here, especially, you know, via internet. A lot of people are watching you, and no pressure, right? We do want to take the pressure off to let you know that we are not casting directors, okay? We cannot cast you in anything. We are merely your peers. We just want to support you. We are on your side. So you don't necessarily have to perform for us. We just want to enhance your audition technique capabilities and give you some constructive criticism. So just relax. Just tell your story. Relax and take it easy.
Yeah, and the most important thing you can do in any audition is be yourself. And that's something that you hear and you will continue to refine and just every time we audition, I'm like, how can I just be more and more of myself? So that's something, so just show up. You showing up, you got everything you need today. So just, you know, take the pressure off. Let's have fun. Let's get into some of this music and some of these pieces. And yeah, we'll
both be able to give you feedback. Sometimes we'll have you go back and redo something, or maybe we won't. It just depends.
Something for you to think about for the next time you do it. So we just want to, it's going to be easy. Yeah. So we're going to have fun.
And are we going to?
Yeah, because right now we just see a picture of ourselves. So
yes, so it'll switch to students. Yes. Awesome.
I mean, she's great to look at, but that other guy, I don't want to look at.
Well, okay, let's go ahead and get started. Thank you so much for those words of encouragement for our performing students. So let's get started. How about we have Jimmy go first?
All right.
And Jimmy, probably with all of you, we'll have you, I don't know, we'll break the ice a little bit. What would you like Jimmy to do before he starts performing?
Jimmy.
Yes.
Tell us an appropriate but funny joke you recently heard.
Oh gosh. Oh my gosh. I do not tell a lot of jokes. Or
a funny story, a funny quip that you heard, or I can make it even easier. What's your favorite color?
Oh, my favorite color is blue right now.
Why blue?
I don't know. Blue is just a really calming and neutral color for me. And I don't know. Whenever I wear blue, I feel good. It feels it's good against my skin tone too. So, yeah.
Awesome.
That's great to know. Great information for us too. and these type of questions, they happen in your audition sometimes. They will ask you a question just off the cuff to sort of break the ice a little bit to see how fast you can think on your feet. Sometimes they will, sometimes they won't. But
and if you don't know a joke, do exactly what you what you did. I don't really tell many jokes. Okay, great. So then they go.
Yeah, I'm usually just funny to look at and talk to. So jokes for me are not needed.
Have one in your back pocket at all times. I think I learned that in college too. They're like, have a joke in your back pocket, something you can recite in an instant.
Awesome.
All right.
All right, Jimmy, take it away whenever you're ready, brother.
Sure. Uncle Morty used to send me to the movies. Here's a nickel, kid. Cheer up and go. And though I was only 7, I discovered heaven at the RKO. Blue lights, pink lights, stars in the ceiling, an organ as big as a Buick, and a screen as tall as the Great Wall of China. Red rugs, gold stairs, porcelain angels, and everything bigger and better and larger than life. See, life wasn't cakes and flashing swords and parapets. Life wasn't Alan Swan or Robin Hood. Life was your father going out for cigarettes and deciding he was going out for good. Here's a nickel, kid. Cheer up and go. Swan is playing at the RKO. Swan, my hero and possible father. He stood and he fought and he never ran. Oh no. I heard myself proclaimed, and by the happy hollow of a tree escaped the hunt. No port, no place that guards and most unusual vigilance does not attend to my taking. Whilst I escape, I will preserve myself in the basest and most poorest shape that ever penury, in contempt of a man brought near to a beast. My face I'll grime in filth, blanket my loins, elf my hair in knots, and with presented nakedness I'll face the winds and persecutions of the sky. The country gives me proof and precedent of bedlam beggars who, with roaring voices, strike at their numbed and mortified bare arms and enforce their charity. Poor Turley God. Poor Tom. Yet that is something. Edgar, I nothing am. Thank you.
Awesome. Great job, brother.
Good job. Good job. How do you feel?
Yeah, I feel good. I think a lot of every time I go to an audition or every time I my performance in front of people, I just think it's easy to look at the things that I did wrong. So I that's just a habit that I always do. So usually like right after I'm like, oh, I did this wrong. So, but I'm proud of all the things that I did right though as well.
Good.
It's important, especially after you graduate school, to sort of identify the things that you did right and the things that you can work on. I never want to say did things wrong, things that you can work on, because in school people, you know, your professors are there to sort of encourage you and to sort of guide you along, but you know, you have to learn yourself what it's going to take to tell this story of, you know, through your song or through your monologue.
Sure.
So as far as your song is concerned, I love that song. Why did you choose that song?
I think it's just a good audition song. It fits well in my voice, but at the same time too, it's also really visual as well. I can convey a character, I convey time, I can convey space, and I get transported in this world, and I want to convey it to the person behind the desk or whoever I'm performing it to also be transported to the world I'm in. So I just think it's a good message.
Great, good. This is our first time doing a virtual workshop, especially for musical theater. So it's a little tricky not having a live piano there, but to my ear, I'm not sure about you, to my ear, it sounded like you were a bit sharp at times. I don't know if you've ever been told that during this song. And it seems as if you have some jaw tension going on. I don't know if you've ever been told that. And for everyone who else is listening, things we may say your professors or teachers may agree with and they may not agree with. Your job is to take a little advice and to leave a little advice and to sort of
take the stuff that applies that you know makes sense.
Exactly. So what I may say, you may agree and you may not, and it's okay. But let's work on a little bit of the job, the technical aspect, because your storytelling is fantastic. Right. I saw everything that you were saying and I was with you the entire way.
Also, before we get into that, Taylor, would you mind giving us like a 2 or 3 minute warning? Just because we don't want to like, we want to make sure that everybody gets the equal amount. Or if we're going too far, whatever, just, you know, keep us on schedule. Yeah.
10 minutes per person or so.
Right.
Perfect.
Yeah. Can we start from the very top with the music?
Yep.
And you won't do the entire thing. I'll sort of cut you off.
Sure. And I have heard that before too, just the jaw tension. Just I need to loosen my, So that's a common thing that I'm working towards.
We still also, we have him in like fours. Is it?
Four squares?
Yeah, is it possible to pin him to
Or no.
Or that he's the full screen or?
I think Jimmy is on full screen for everybody that's watching the event. It's possible that since you're a presenter, you're seeing kind of four different screens.
Oh, okay.
You can try right clicking on that specific screen and see if it goes full.
Awesome, thank you.
Not sure if that works though.
Okay, well.
It's okay.
Yep.
It's all right.
Cool.
Uncle Morty used to send me to the movies. Here's a nickel, kid. Cheer up and go.
Hey,
and though I was only 7.
Do you take a breath right before you start? It starts right away. Uncle Morty, can you take a breath for me right before you start, like a catch breath through your nose? Uncle Morty,
Yep.
And yeah, do that for me really quickly.
Uncle Morty used to send me to the movies. Here's a nickel, kid. Cheer up and go. And though I was home.
I guess this will be the key to like, we're good. So you can I'll do that for everyone. We'll do that for everyone. So that was different for me. It sort of gave you, you relaxed a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. Right away. Can you do me a favor and drop your jaw, stand up straight?
Yep.
Just drop your jaw a little bit open. And everybody can do this. Everybody watching, all the other people that are performing, let's all do that. Just relax, drop your jaw a little bit. Open, yeah, don't force it, just open. And take your fingers, your pointer finger, and go back to this spot right here. It's kind of tender, it's right, let me get my hair out of my veins. It's right here, you kind of push in, it's your jaw.
Uh-huh.
There's some tension here, it should feel really uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Push in really hard, keep your jaw open, not pressure. Push in and just massage it, both directions backwards, circular motions forward. Now, from there, say, Uncle Morty, start your song just like this, relaxed, go.
Uncle Morty used to send me to the movies. Uh-huh. Here's a nickel, kid. Cheer up and go.
Yeah, that oh, right. It was so beautiful. Yes. It came out so heavenly. It was very light. It was easier for you. It sounded easy for us as well. Because right now, you had tension in your lips and your jaw, so it came out, cheer up and go, and it was just seemed a little tight. Cheer up and go, right? It's a little lighter. It takes the tension and the pressure off. So start it again for me with the massage.
With the music?
With the music, please, sorry. Relax every vowel.
Uncle Morty used to send me to the movies.
Yeah.
Here's a nickel, kid. Cheer up and go. And though I was only 7, I discovered heaven at the RKO. Blue light.
RKO. Take it easy on those O's because I think that's where you get sharp.
Okay.
All right. But otherwise, I think your storytelling
is
great and you sound great. I just want you to relax a little bit. Relax your, you know, find some exercises to relax your tongue.
Mm-hmm.
Put your tongue at the back of your teeth. Everybody can do this. And push forward. Push as hard as you can. It should feel really uncomfortable because your tongue goes all the way back down here, right? And make a little noise. Go, ah, ah. Smile. Ah.
Ah.
Right? It should be uncomfortable. If it's really, if it's really tight and uncomfortable, you know that you have a lot of tension. So try to do that before you sing or even do monologues, okay?
Uh-huh.
Awesome. So going to the monologue, and what I'm gonna say is gonna apply to both the monologue and the song, and this is for everyone. Tell me really quickly, we have a couple of minutes, what is the summary of your monologue?
The summary of my monologue is I'm basically being exiled or banished from the place, my home, and I'm basically taking another life. And I was once a prince, and now I'm basically transforming myself into a creature, a woodland creature, a very poor man.
And do you know what happens immediately before you speak in this monologue?
I'm being chased.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Your job is to know specifically what is happening right before this monologue starts. Because there's a moment before in every single thing that you do, even your song, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's a moment that happens because life doesn't just exist in a bubble, like it's happening at all times. So the best thing that you can do is really, when you're sitting outside waiting for your turn to go in, you focus on your moment before. What is happening right before the first word of my monologue or the first word of my song? That way, when you go in, you take that breath, that centering, that grounding breath that she was talking about, and we see everything come to life. We see your entire world in that breath in your eyes, and then you start. What is the first, your first line of the monologue?
I heard myself proclaimed, and by the happy hollow of a tree, escaped the hunt.
Right, so take a moment, stand up.
Mm-hmm.
You're being chased.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
You come into this area, take mm-hmm. a deep breath, and just bring that energy of, I've stopped, and now I'm having this conversation with myself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Great. I heard myself proclaimed, and by the happy hollow of a tree escaped the hunt.
No Great. Point. Great. So the best thing that you can do for any monologue, any song, is be as specific as you can, right? So that's why with Shakespeare, it's dense, right? Mm-hmm. Make sure that you know every single word of that monologue. It came through very clearly. Know that. But there, with Shakespeare, you can always go deeper, right? Pulling away the layers is key. And what I found is there is no word in Shakespeare, no word that we can kind of go, I think I know what that means, and kind of like gloss over it. You need to know every single, if you have a whilst or an if or anything like that, if you know specifically what you're saying, it comes through. The moment you don't know specifically, we start to feel that you don't know specifically. And your final moment, just like there's a moment before, there's a moment after. So your last line is?
Edgar, I nothing am.
Right. So he's talking about himself. And then what happens immediately after that? Does he flee? Does he stand still? Does he contemplate? And sometimes this will be something that you need to make up. But mm-hmm. your audition is not over until you've said your last line, and then you've had your final moment as an actor, right? Because we're still watching you. Mm-hmm. We're watching how you let this moment hang in the air that we've just seen. And if you drop it and release it, then we don't buy into it as much. If you hold us to the last breath, that's when we go, oh, he knew exactly what he was talking about. He got the entire severity or the breadth of this piece, and he understood it. So your moment before and your moment after are your strongest friends in an audition, whether you're doing a monologue or a song. And I think we're probably out of time, but that for me is gold right there. You did a great job, Jimmy.
Awesome. Thank you, Q and Lawrence.
Yeah.
You're welcome, honey. And that's a great audition outfit, by the way.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Taylor, fantastic. You're on mute.
Yeah, fantastic. Great job, Jimmy. All right, next, let's have Aubrey perform.
Hi. Let me move my couch out of my way, sorry. Can you guys see me okay?
Yep.
Okay, awesome. Can you ride down the line? Jamie's convinced that the problems are mine. Jamie is probably just fine. And I'm still hurting.
You for 20 minutes, babe.
You don't try to pull away. They don't look at your face. And they don't try to kiss you. All they do is wrap you up in their arms and hold on tight without an edge of selfishness to it. I hope you become addicted. I hope you become addicted to saving things. And having them matter to someone. Thank you.
Good job, honey.
Awesome.
Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. How are you feeling about it?
I feel good. I always love performing emotional pieces, so awesome. It gets me giddy.
You tap into it very, very well, your emotional side. Do you want to start backwards? Do you want to start with the monologue first, and then I can?
No.
Okay. Yeah. The last 5 years, you guys are choosing some really great songs. I saw the last performance of that on Broadway. It was amazing, and how Prince was there. It was amazing. I love that song. I love that piece.
It sounded great.
And we didn't ask her a funny story or joke, right. But we'll do that at the very end. We'll do
Absolutely.
That. Let's get through this. So yes, you're very talented. Have you ever been in love before?
Yes.
That's a very personal question, right?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Yeah. I'm still hurting. You tell the story very well. Can you do me a favor and start from the top with the music again?
Okay. Yes.
Put it down just like
just a
notch
hair.
Or two.
The
a notch.
Music.
Sure. Okay. Yes, I can do that.
And Aubrey, think about that moment before.
Sorry?
Think about that moment before, right before this first lyric. Think about what has happened. Has he walked out? Has he said something? Have you been sitting on a bench? You know, it doesn't have to be exactly the way the show is, but what is the specific moment before for you? And then just have that going on.
Okay, thank you.
Beautiful. Yeah. So when you flip, what about life, Jamie? Da-da-da-da, swore to be true. You go from chest voice to you flip it to your head voice, right? That's tricky,
yeah.
Right?
Uh-huh.
The thing about that is not pushing that lighter side. I forgot the lyrics. What about life, Jamie? Da-da-da-da. What can you speak the lyrics for me?
What about lies, Jamie? What about things that you swore to be true?
Right. Without the music, can you sing that little section for me? I want to try to help you with something, technically.
What about lies, Jamie? What about things that you swore to be true?
It sounds beautiful. There's very little that I need to help you with, but thank you. But swore to be true. Can you start backing away from the sound before you get to true? What about life, Jamie? Did it swore to be true? It'll make it just more ethereal, more, I guess, emotional as well. Try it again and back off a little sooner before you even get to true.
Okay. What about lies, Jamie? What about things that you swore to be true?
Mm-hmm. You can keep working on it. What, one more time and I'll swore happy and swore. That's tricky because it's right in that mix, right?
So yeah.
R. That's really tricky, especially on that vowel. Swore to be true. So lighten that word up. Swore to be true. Lighten it up a little bit.
Okay. What about lies, Jamie? What about things that you swore to be true?
Yeah, it's beautiful. I have very little to say about the song. I mean, that's just a very small thing, but beautiful job.
Really? And also, I wonder if just another layer on it from the acting standpoint, right? Yes, you're hurting. Yes, you've been betrayed. But now you're specifically saying, what about the lies, right? What about the things you swore to be true? And how do you feel about that? In that, like when you're recounting, like let's say a best friend said that they would keep all your secrets, right? They would keep all your secrets. And then you're confronting them and you're saying, you know, you said you would keep my secrets and you didn't. Like you didn't keep my secrets. And even in that, you can feel where you begin to back off on the volume, right? Because you're recounting, like you lied to me. Like you said you were gonna be there and you weren't, right? Even in that natural way, then you can begin to feel, oh, that might help inform like where the volume starts to shift and all that stuff. Your monologue was great too. It's from Waitress, right?
Yes.
Great. And she is carrying a child, right?
Yeah.
So she's speaking to her baby. So again, I'm gonna be a broken record with this moment before, moment after thing, because not only is it about specificity, but it really helps the auditioner, the actor, it helps them go, okay, it's starting, but here's my moment. Here's my moment to own this. Give me take a beat, think about the specifics right before you speak, and then go into that. 2 minutes.
Real quick, give me 1 second. We have a little bit of a technical difficulty with the stream, and I'm gonna try and fix something up real quick.
Awesome.
Give me one moment and see if this works.
You got more time for your moment before.
Yeah. Okie dokie.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. You can. Oh, my goodness.
No, all righty. Taylor.
Oh, no, not yet.
Yes.
I have a brief issue with the stream at the moment, so I'm going to bounce out real quick and jump back in. I don't think it will end the stream for anybody, but if for some reason it does end the stream for you, all you have to do is just re-click the link and join back in. But awesome. I will be back in 2 seconds.
Great. Okay.
And Taylor, I know our Q&A is probably about.
Yes.
But
if we need to go into it.
If we need to go into it, if it ends up being 30-minute Q&A, I think that's, you know, 45 minutes, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
Know that we're okay with that.
Perfect. And, you know, let's go ahead and have a couple questions right now while Bill is out so that we can, you know, and sorry, Aubrey, to.
You're good. It's all good.
You know, during your time, but just while Bill is out, we'll just have time for a couple questions. So we had a question from one of the attendees, and they would like to know, how do they sing with more confidence?
I think one of the things is to know your material, right? Choose a song or a monologue that you absolutely love, that speaks to your heart, something that you can relate to. Don't choose something that is so far out of reach, like far out of your age range, emotional reach. Try something that, if you love to tell funny stories, funny jokes or whatever, find a funny monologue or a funny song and start feeling more comfortable with that. That's number one, I think.
And I would say, and this is again, something that you will be working at your entire career. When you truly believe that you are enough, it just helps. Like this is a tough business, right? There is always going to be someone who is, that you think is more talented, can sing better, can sing higher, can sing lower, can do riffs, can do runs, all of that. But if you believe truly that there is no one that can do what you can do, then you, the comparison game is out. And I've always found that, like, when I'm not comparing myself to anybody else except my, other than my last performance, that I'm just so much more confident. And also having material that you love helps too, because then it's like, I like this, I'm enough, and all I have to do is be me. All I have to do is show up. I don't have to do anything else.
That is fantastic. Oh, okay. I'm having some difficulty sending myself live as well, but if can everybody still hear me?
Yep.
Okay, great. So that is fantastic advice, I think, for everybody, whether that's, you know, singing more confidently, acting more confidently, or just performing more confidently in any state. So thank you so much for that. And let's go ahead and answer one more question. What Broadway shows have you both performed in?
I am currently in Come From Away, which is a poster right back here. And before that, I did Mary Poppins. And before that, I did Les Miserables, the first revival on Broadway.
Yeah. And the last show that I did on Broadway was The Book of Mormon. And before that, I was in Hair. And before that, I was in a show called Passing Strange on Broadway. There's all musicals so far.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to try to send Aubrey live. And okay. if you know, if we're still figuring that out, I know Bill is switching computers, but if we're still figuring that out, we can go ahead. We have several more questions that we can awesome. We can ask during this time too. So thanks awesome. For bearing with us. So let me try to send her live. We can just go ahead and jump back into where we were, if that is okay with Q and Lawrence.
Let's do it. So we are getting ready to do this. Beginning of monologue. Aubrey, right?
Yes.
Awesome. We don't see her just, oh, there she is. Awesome. There you are. Okay, great. So you had a little bit of a breath. So yeah, just take that moment before, fill it, fill yourself with all of those circumstances, those given circumstances, and then let's see you have this conversation with your unborn child, right?
Dear baby, I hope someday somebody wants to hold you for 20 minutes straight. They don't pull away. They don't look at your face. They don't try to kiss you. All they do is wrap you up in their arms and hold on tight without an edge of selfishness to you. I hope you become addicted, baby. I hope you become addicted to saying things, having them matter to someone. Thank you.
Great. Awesome. So some things to think about, right? And these are just questions that I want you to think about and then apply as you see fit. Because you're an artist, you're an individual, you're unique. Someone else will do this monologue and they will do it their way. This is just your way. Is there a moment in this monologue where you talk directly to your baby? Like, this is, you know, like, you're carrying a child at this point still, correct, right? If I'm correct, I don't wanna mislead you. Is there a moment where the child that is in your body, you speak directly to, as opposed to, yes, we wanna, you know, we wanna, you're having this conversation out loud, but is there a moment where it becomes more intimate, where you, the mother, are talking directly to your child, right? Just that would give you a different level, right? Deeper sense of intimacy with what you're saying to your child. Also, your moment after. And what I mean by moment after is, I mean, your last word is what? Your last three words are what?
And having them matter to someone.
And having them matter to someone. And what does that mean to you? After you've said it, how does that resonate with you, the mother who has just said it? And then we want to see that. then your monologue is over, right? Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. Yes, a lot of times, like, we're told, like, only sing 16 bars. You have 60 seconds for a monologue. But I have never, ever gone into an audition and been specific and confident and detailed and had someone stop me, right? Mm-hmm. What I mean by that is the more you can own it, you can hold people for, you know, I'm not saying make a 1 minute monologue 3 minutes, but that final moment, you can take your time, because if you believe it, then I'm believing it. And I don't want to see you fall out of it until you tell me you're done, right? Mm-hmm. So these yeah. are some things that I want you to think about, but it was very well done. Very well done. You're able to tap into that. So just keep digging deeper. Don't stop. Don't ever stop, because you can always go deeper. Okay. Great job.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
All right. Who should we have go next? How about Brannon?
I have to ask for a funny story.
Oh, we're coming back to you with a funny story, Aubrey. We'll come back.
Awesome. Look at my style, could it be more glam? Look at my look, can you say hot damn? Look, and I want you to know who I am. Me, I'm fabulous, baby.
Okay.
Ooh. Look at my moves, don't they blow your mind? Drama and talent and sex combined. Hell, you can tell even if you're blind. See, I'm fabulous, baby. I'm meant to be where the spotlight shines. Born to be on display. Built to be dressed to the 99s and ready to stand and say, hey, look at me, can't you see? I'm fabulous, baby. Look right here, ain't it clear where I'm heading to? And look at the time, honey, I can't stay. Look while you can, cause I'm on my way. Me, I'm fabulous, baby. I've got fabulous things to do.
I hate the bus. I want my own car. A car with a heater. I want a TV set and more. A big old house like this one, but everything new. Or can't nobody ever tell me what to do? I'll go out if I want to. If I don't, then I'll stay. Got magical bracelets so bullets bounce away. In every room, a TV and my own telephone. And I'll live in that house. I'll live in my house by myself, all alone. And if I'm lonely, doesn't matter, because I know there's worse than being lonely. There are people who freeze while they wait on their knees, and they don't know for what, and they just been forgot. And I ain't waiting no more. You just wait forever if you can't say what for. The day comes soon, I'll pack up the nothing I own, and I'll live in that house. I'll live in my house, by myself, all alone. Thank you.
Great job.
Good job, Brennan. Good job. How are you feeling about your performance?
I feel okay. I don't know. I got nervous like in the middle of it, but I feel okay now.
Got nervous in the middle of both song and monologue, or?
The monologue, only because I've never done it as a monologue. So I was kind of, so I was a little nervous for that, but yes.
Good job though, honey. We'll start with the.
Yeah, we'll start with the monologue. I recommend everyone mm-hmm. perform their song as a monologue, right? Because especially musicals that you know, that you've heard, because it's really easy to kind of just like get in the do it by rote, like do it how Anika did it, you know what I mean? Sing it exactly how she sang it, because we're so used to hearing her voice. But when you perform it as a monologue, which is what you just did, and you put your own take on it, then you bring all of those beats and moments into your version of the song, right? And it leads to things like in your song, Fabulous Baby, there was a lyric where you didn't sing it, you kind of spoke it. And I know the song, but I don't know it well enough to know if that's how it was recorded, but it leads to moments like that, right? If I'm lonely, doesn't matter. And that's very melodic that she, if I'm lonely, it doesn't matter. But if your version, we want to see it acted. A casting, they want to see you, they want to see people with great voices, which you have, but they also want to know that you understand what you're saying. And that's why performing it as a monologue, any piece, is good for you because it helps you go, wait, do I really know what they mean? Question for you, where's the house? Right now, where's the house?
There. I didn't place it.
Right. In the future, place the house because you're like that one. This one, you know, you're specifically talking about that house and everything new. And that gives you a focus. You know, if you're standing in front of the house, is the house behind you? Is it in front of you? Can you see it? You know, while you're standing waiting for that bus that you hate. Those kinds of specific moments, it just makes you go, I know exactly, I'm standing in front of this house. And then it's feeding you. So that's great. That's great. You didn't place it, but now you will never not place it. And that's going to help. You want to?
Mm-hmm. You want to her to do a part of it? She's talking to describe the house.
Yeah. Actually, the part of the monologue or the part of the song that if I'm lonely doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Can you start right there?
Yeah. And if I'm lonely, doesn't matter. I think there's worse than being lonely. There are people who freeze while they wait on their knees and they don't know for what and they just been forgot. And I ain't waiting no more. Okay, you just wait forever. Okay.
Great. So right there at that switch, if I'm lonely, doesn't matter. I think there's worse than being lonely, right? She's professing there's people, what is it?
There's people who freeze while they wait on their knees.
And they don't know for what, and they've just been forgot. And then there's a transition, and it happens in the music too, right? So for you, I want to see that transition. There's people who freeze while they wait on their knees, and they can't say for what, and they've just been forgot. Take a moment, and then let us know who you are. Who are you? Keep going at that moment.
Okay. You want me to do it again?
Yeah, from there are people who freeze, and then when you get to that part, and they've just been forgot, and then tell us, but I ain't waiting no more. You know what I mean? You're deciding I'm gonna be different.
Okay. And if I'm lonely, doesn't matter. I think there's worse than being lonely. There are people who freeze while they wait on their knees, and they don't know for what, and they just been forgot. And I ain't waiting no more. You just wait forever if you can't say what for. The day comes soon, and I'll pack up the nothing I own, and I'll live in that house. I'll live in my house, by myself, all alone.
You gave me chills.
Good.
You gave me chills. Thank you. Oh, right.
Yeah, so let's 3 minutes. Go to the song.
Yeah. And this kind of bleeds over into what I'm going to talk to you about the song is what's the title of the song?
Fabulous Baby.
She says that 50,000 times, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Every time you sing it, it has to be a reason why you sing it. Every time. So as Brennan, right? I love you, I love your family, I know a little bit about you, but what makes you fabulous? What qualities do you have within yourself personally? Like, tell me what things you love about yourself, you as a person.
I think I have a really like positive energy that I think people can feed off of.
Tell me another one. Yep, keep going.
I have a lot of passion for helping people. I love that about myself.
Right. Cool attributes. What else?
I have my eyes. My eyes are hazel, and I get a lot of compliments on that.
Do you love them, right?
Yes, I love my eyes.
Yes. What else do you love about your body?
I love my skin. I love my smile.
Great.
Yeah.
Every time you say me, I'm fabulous, baby. Physically touch something that you love about yourself. If it's your passion, show us your passion. If it's your eyes, I'm fabulous, baby. Like, it has to be a reason behind every time you say I'm fabulous. It has to grow and grow and grow and grow, right? Because every time you sang it, it was kind of like, me, I'm fabulous, baby. Yes, I'm fabulous. Every time you say it, you're fabulous. Okay, we know you're fabulous. So think about that. Every time you say it, it has to be a reason why. The second thing, technically, you did a riff that was really low and then you went really high. It was in the very center of the song. I don't know the words, the lyrics enough to tell you exactly what lyrics they were. Do you know what I'm talking about? It was a riff that went down.
Yeah. They're like, and ready to stand and say, hey.
Okay.
I think that
part. Yes. Whatever that was, whatever low note that you hit in that little riff, you were thinking of the next thing already. So you didn't quite get to the low note. So what I want to say, when you have a really low note that you think is out of your range, most likely it isn't. Most likely the issue is that you are pushing to get there. So think light. Don't push to get there. So gosh, I wish I knew the lyric. Say the lyric for me one more time, the one that you think it is.
And ready to stand and say hey.
Yeah, is it ready?
Yeah.
Okay, well, whatever it is, think up, right? Think up, because when you think low, you kind of go out of the pitch a little bit. But if you think ready, everybody do this, go ready. Everybody say ready, everybody go.
Ready.
Again, ready.
Ready.
Now push it, go ready. Put some meat and weight on it, go ready. Go.
Ready.
Now do the same thing, lift your eyebrows and go ready, smile with it. Everybody go ready, smile.
Ready. Ready.
It's the same pitch, but it's lighter, it's not pushed, and it's in tune. Ready. So if you think there's a note that's too low, most likely it isn't. Just think up on those lower notes. I could say more, but I think we're out of time, but think about those things. You're great.
Can I just add 30 seconds, one thing? You the best advice, when you have a song like I'm Fabulous Baby, because you're saying it so much and you want everyone to be specific, but also this is where you can play with subtext, meaning you describe all the things that you like about yourself. So if someone zapped you and all you could ever say all day was I'm fabulous, baby, but you had to communicate, you know, even if like you lost $50, I'm fabulous, baby. I like, you know, so you have an opportunity when you say I'm fabulous, baby, your subtext is, do you like my eyes? Because I love them. Do you like this skin? Because I love. So whether or not you touch it or not, the subtext under every single one is specific. You're not just saying I'm fabulous, baby. You're saying I'm fabulous, baby. That one was about my eyes. You're saying I'm fabulous, baby. I like the way my body is, you know, whatever. Play with that subtext in a song like that. It makes it great because every time you say it, every fabulous is going to be different and unique.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Great job.
Thank you.
Fantastic job, Brandon. All right, we have two students left to go. Let's go with Nadia next.
Hello.
Hi, Nadia.
Hi.
Where in the world have you traveled that you absolutely love? Have you traveled anywhere cool?
Yeah, I went to Calgary, Canada, Calgary, Alberta, 2 summers ago, and it was the like most serene, peaceful, beautiful, kind-hearted place I've ever been. And I'm from Nebraska, so that says a lot.
Yes.
That's awesome.
I was there for a week.
Nice, cool. Nice. It's beautiful there. I've been there too.
Yeah, I went there was like a big holiday, like event that they celebrate for that week, where they all wear like cowboy hats and there's horses everywhere, and it was awesome.
Great. I saw so much of your personality through what you just told us.
Absolutely.
And this is what you need to take into the audition room. Yep. Exactly that. Don't put on any fronts or anything. Okay. Just do exactly, just be exactly who you are.
Exactly who you are.
So let's start, shall we?
Yes.
Sometimes I wonder where I've been, who I am, and do I feel, make believe it's hard alone. I'll keep on my own. We're always proving who we are, always reaching for that rising star to guide me far and shine me home. I'll keep on my own. But when I'm down and feeling blue, I close my eyes so I can be with you. Oh, baby, be strong for me. Baby, be loved to me. Help me be you.
I can as well be hanged as tell the manner of it. This is mere foolery. I did not mark it. Okay. I saw Mark Antony offer him the crown, yet it was not a crown neither. It was one of those coronets, and as I told you, he put it by once, but for all that to my thinking, he would have fain have had it. Then she offered it to him again, and he put it by again, but to my thinking, he was very loath to lay his fingers off of it. And then she offered it to him the third time, and he put it the third time by, and still, as he refused the crown, the rabblements houted and clapped their chop hands and threw up their sweaty nightcaps and uttered such a deal of stinking breath, because, oh, Caesar refused the crown, that it had almost choked Caesar, for he swounded and fell down at it, and for mine own part, well, I durst not laugh for fear of opening my lips and receiving the bad air. Thank you.
Awesome.
Good job. Good job. How do you feel about your performance?
Okay. So over the past, in the fall, I transferred schools, and with the transfer, I changed my major from musical theater to theater performance, which is basically just an acting degree. So over the past like 2 years, I took a year off of school before. And so over the past 2 years, I haven't trained in musical theater at all. So I was really nervous because I haven't been singing and I haven't been vocally training. So when I was choosing a song, I didn't know what song to choose because my voice has changed a lot. So a lot of the songs that I sing, I'm more comfortable singing in my mix, but I don't know why. I don't know. I chose Out Here on My Own because I like resonate with the character of Coco. So it felt right, but then I was also like battling my inner voice. It's like, you can't sing this song anymore. Your voice is different. So a lot of emotions.
Well, congrats for not listening to those voices entirely. You know what I mean? Congrats for going, I'm struggling, but I'm gonna do this, because that's literally
real.
Every performer's.
That's real.
I literally just went through the same thing, right? So, and it's gonna happen again later down the line. So bravo for going, you know what? I have more confidence in myself to perform this song than I do uncertainty. So bravo.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So your strength, you think your vocal strength is your mix? Mm-hmm. Having a mix and doing it well is very tricky. And you are correct. It is, your mix is beautiful. Your lower range is delicious.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that? Normally I have to sort of help people reach those lower notes without pushing too hard. but they're beautifully done. But there's a section in your song, maybe belong to me. Oh Lord, I don't know the lyrics well enough. Can you start from, I know this may be tricky, from the middle of your, like the bridge, sort of towards the end? I'll probably stop you, but I don't know if you can. Start from the top.
Okay, with the music or without?
The music, and I'll just do this when I've heard enough.
Okay.
Sometimes I wonder where I've been, who I am, do I fit in, make believe it is hard alone. Out here on my own, they're always probing who we are, always reaching for that rising star to guide me far and shine me home. Out here on my own. But when I'm down and feeling blue, I close my eyes so I can be with you. Oh.
Right. Your vows is very technical. It's very, very minimal. I have very little to say vocally. But the E's, when you sing your E's, they're a little strained, just the tiniest bit to my ear. Can you make it a B-E-A, like B, smile a little bit and drop your jaw a little bit? Because right now it's B, instead of okay, B, okay. Make it a little lighter, take the pressure off of your chords. Yeah. Yeah. Start, yeah, what's before that? Get into it for me.
Okay.
I know it's tricky. I know.
I close my eyes so I can be with you.
Sort of. This is a small. One more time. Take it a little easier. Be with you.
I close my eyes so I can be.
Yeah. That's better. That's definitely better, right? Instead of be with, that's a different different placement. But on your E's, try to make it sort of like a EA to take the tension off of your vocal cords a little bit, okay?
And also think about releasing the note as opposed to hitting the note. Mm-hmm. You know, like when you like, just think about you've got the note. The note is there. You have no problems with it, and now you're just releasing it.
Okay.
You're just releasing it out of yourself.
That's all I want to say. Just work on your vowels, specifically the E's and the A's. That's it.
Awesome. Thank you.
On the acting side, I have to tell you, I believe you. Like I could tell where you were. I can tell how it was resonating with you throughout the song. For your Shakespeare monologue, I like the idea of modernizing Shakespeare, right? Kind of bringing your own personality to it, and I think that's great. Again, specificity, especially when you're taking liberties, right? You've got to know every single word that you're saying. And also, when you are adapting it a little bit, not doing it like in the time that it was, just make sure that your choices don't stray too far from what you bring naturally. When you told us about your trip to Canada, there was so much personality in that. I could hear you do the monologue that way. I felt a little bit like you were putting more character on it than it needed, because you have all of that energy. You have all of that vivaciousness in you. So just let that shine through. You don't have to bring it from somewhere else, or the idea of just bring all that from here. and then it resonates, it translates. Yeah. Great job.
Thank you both so much.
Yeah.
Wonderful job.
Fantastic job, Nadia. All right, so last we have Elliot Purdy.
You want to ask him?
Yes.
Say hi, Elliot.
Hello? Is that working? I don't know.
There we go.
Can you guys hear me?
Hey, yep. Elliot, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Great. Elliot, tell me one of your favorite moments from last summer.
Oh, there was a lot. Probably going to the lake and NHSTA, actually. That was a really good time.
Awesome. All right, brother. Well, jump into it.
All right. Yep. All right. Bring him peace, bring him joy, he is young, he is only a boy, you can take.
Listen, fellas, I know somebody put you up to this. Probably paid you some extra money, too, yeah? Well, that ain't right. Holds of things worth nothing but gutter rats. And with no respect for each other or anything. And is that who we are? Yeah, we stab each other in the backs, and I guess that's who we are. But if we stand together, we can change the whole game. And it ain't just about us. You know, all over the city, there are boys and girls who ought to be out playing or going to school. Instead, they're slaving ways to support themselves and their families. It ain't no crime being poor. And not one of us complains that the work we do is hard. All we ask is a fair deal. You know, and for every kid in every sweatshop, factory, and slaughterhouse in this town, I beg you, put down your papers and join the strike. Thank you.
Awesome. Great job.
Good job. You want to start or do you?
Yeah, sure. Remind me where that monologue is from.
It's from Newsies. It's Jack Kelly talking to the scabs when they're like starting to sell papers.
Right. Okay. Are you completely off book?
It's been a year. So, I mean, I had to bring it back and.
Yeah. Perfect. Here's the thing. The reason why I asked is because you don't ideally, yes, you know, let's be off book if you can, but it's not a deal breaker as long as you're in the moment to moment. So if you think you're off book and then all of a sudden, because nerves creep in, this is for anybody, and you don't, that's why they always say, you know, have it close to you, you know, in case you have to go for it. So your moment before for me and your moment after, I feel like you can get a little bit more specific with that, because he is rallying the troops, so to speak, right? So he comes in hot, right?
Right.
And at the end of this thing, he needs to have convinced these people to join up his cause. So for me, I want you to think about the stakes. What does it mean if you walk away from this speech and they all go, nah, forget it?
The entire story is like gone, because then they're selling them and those guys just kind of left.
Right. So you can't afford to not win them over with this monologue. Like, that's right. Not an option for you. And so some things that I would say, it's good. It's good. And like, as you say, as we dust it off, then you fall back into your groove. Some things for you to think about in the future. Do people start to trickle off? Not everybody. Does one person kind of go, forget it? And how does that affect you as you see that one person leave? Oh crap, I can't lose another one. So let's change tactics a little bit. Like, is there a spot in the monologue for you to kind of switch it up? You're going at them hard. Is there a chance for you to like come off the brakes a little bit and kind of like appeal to their sensibility? Take it from the top for me. We're just gonna go a couple of lines and.
All right. Listen, fellas, I know somebody put you up to this. Probably paid you some extra money too, yeah? Well, it ain't right. Bolts of things were gutter rats with no respect for anything, including each other. Is that who we are? Well, yeah, we'll stab each other in the backs, and that's who we are.
Great. When they have you do it one more time, when you get to that question, is that who we are? Really ask it. And you ask it twice.
Okay.
Why is that? Why does he have to ask that question twice?
I feel like for him, it's just like the first one is really asking, and the second one is like him asking, but then him just answering it for them so that they're all on the same page, if that makes sense.
Okay, let me see that. Let me see the first one be a little bit more general, and the second one, him telling them.
Okay.
Yep.
Listen, fellas, I know somebody put you up to this. Probably paid you some extra money too, yeah? Well, that ain't right. Holds of things were gutter rats with no respect for anything, including each other. Is that who we are? Well, yeah, we'll stab each other in the backs, and I guess that's who we are. But if we stand together, we can change the whole game, and it just ain't about us. All over the city, there are boys and girls who ought to be out playing or going to school. Instead, they're slaving away to support themselves and their folks.
Great. Good. Yeah, like for me, you're dropping in more, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. It's centering you more. So, yeah, I'm a broken record, but that specificity, you feel more comfortable when you have more specificity?
Yeah.
Yeah, it really is the thing that calms us down, cuz we feel like, all right, I know where this guy is coming from in this moment. I'm not grasping trying to bring it in. Good job, brother. Yep. Good job.
Thank you.
Yeah, bring him home is one of my favorite things. I'll cry every night listening to that song. Every night. I love that song. Why did you choose that song to sing?
So a little bit of a story time, actually. My entire life, like since the movie version of Les Mis came out, has been like my thing. Like, I watch it all the time, that music. And it's just like hands down my favorite. You know, my mom is actually my choir director and musical director here in North Platte. And I always tried to put a bug in her, like, do this. And she never did. So then, you know, when this whole thing went south and we all started having, you know, stay home and stuff, we were finding peace in music. Like, we were using it to kind of cope. And she brought home a musical book and we're just flipping through it. And that one came in and, you know, I sang through it. And for me, it just like that song specifically just like brought a bunch of peace to me. So then that, and it was fresh. So when I decided I was going to sing for this, I was like, you know, I think that's my choice.
Well, good. This is all directly from your mouth. Peace is the word here. Okay. So peace means centered. It means quiet. It means still, vocally, physically. So sometimes your focus was at different places. I don't know who you were talking to exactly. I didn't know. You're shifting from time to time. It was a beautiful performance, don't get me wrong. But let's be more specific here. Who are you talking to?
Well, in the show, he's talking to Marius, but it's also like a big prayer. like he's praying to keep him safe mm-hmm. through all this, so that, you know, even if the worst happens and Valjean is to, like, you know, die, Marius is still there for Cosette.
Can you start the song with the music with your eyes closed? And then when I've had enough, I'll vocally come in and say, thank you, I've had enough. Like, I'll let okay. you know it's time to stop. But I need you to sing the song with your eyes closed, hands out okay. of your pockets,
mm-hmm.
and begin the song with music, please.
Bring him peace, bring him joy. He is love, he is only a fool. You can
Thank you. Did that feel any different?
Yeah, I felt like a lot more like settled in, if that makes sense. Like set in. Like I knew what I was trying to convey.
Good. Now do it again with your eyes open. Drop deep in. Share your prayer with us. This earnest prayer with us.
Okay.
Stillness is key. You use the word peace. It's right. The key word. Go for it.
Bring him peace. Bring him joy. He is only a boy.
Okay. That was different for us out here, mm-hmm. for sure. Did it feel different to you this time?
Yeah,
it's beautiful. I don't have a lot to say about your vocal quality or technique because it's beautiful. Your placement was great. Your breath control was great. But it's really about the storytelling. Right. But just keep repeating. Let that be your subtext. The prayer, peace, stillness, earnestness. Let that be your subtext throughout this song, right? And that'll... Right. Sort of guide you vocally as well, you know, where to take the song and how to maneuver through the song. But I think you did great. It's just something to think about as you continue to practice and learn.
Can I add?
Yeah.
And great job. And this kind of leads into what we're going to get to the next part, because why we like doing these things is we've been doing this for a little while, right? And so when you're in it on a daily basis, things begin to click that you hear, right? Things that people have said to you. So it's an action. When we audition, we're saying, hey, we think we're right for this. This is our version of that. But so many things get in the way. Like we're thinking about, where's my voice today? Did I warm up enough? Do I know all these notes? Do I know the thing? For you, if you ever perform this as an audition, the only thing that you need to concern yourself with before you walk in is you need to say, Elliot, all you have to do is go in the room and pray. Because that action, and it came from your mouth, right? But that action dropped you in and centered you. And for anybody else that's listening, it's things like that. I call it the Jedi mind trick. Then all of a sudden, instead of you going in and auditioning with all the nerves, I'm an actor, I'm auditioning, you kind of throw all that out the window, right? And you go, okay, I'm sitting outside and they call your name and you get up and you walk in the room and you hand the accompanist your music and you say, this is what I'm saying. And you take your beat and you close your eyes and you remember, all I need to do is pray. Mm-hmm. And then the music starts and you audition, but the action is I'm praying and then everything drops in. You know what you're saying, you know, like your body is taken over. Those are the kinds of things that you want to do, because that is really what allows you to go into an audition, and whether it goes as perfectly as you planned or not, you walk away and you're like, I was in the moment. Like I knew what was going on. Mm-hmm. And I was in the moment, and that was the best that I had at that moment. And you get to leave every audition with your head up, whether it went smoothly or whether there were some bumps in the road. So great job, man. Great job.
Thank you.
Yes. Taylor, we want to ask Aubrey and Brennan questions.
Okay, yes. Sounds good.
Q&A.
Absolutely. All right. Let's go with Aubrey.
Let me do it.
Yeah.
Okay. Aubrey.
Yes. Yeah, so
tell us. Oh. Is she there?
Go ahead.
We'll give her a chance.
I'm here.
Okay. Do you know a knock knock joke?
No. No.
A joke?
Probably somewhere deep in my memory.
Deep in your memory? What was the last time you laughed out loud? What made you like literally laugh out loud? Or made you type LOL?
I don't know. I have a 4-year-old brother. He just turned 4. Mm-hmm. This morning he's a very free spirit. And so this morning he was out jumping on the trampoline. And he came inside without his clothes on. And he was like, well, it was wet. And so then he just went out and he just kept jumping on the trampoline in the backyard, just open and confident. And,
and he's going to thank you for telling the story on this stream too one day.
I love that. Yeah. That made me laugh out loud.
That you should keep that one. Yeah, keep that one in your back pocket. That's great. Yeah. And again, guys, we're asking you this for many reasons. A lot of times it helps just like go, oh, like I'm a real person and they're asking me something and I'm not just this robot that has to nail this audition. And then it also helps you go, yeah, like, okay, that was a funny story. And then you're still remembering your brother naked on a trampoline and then the music starts and you kind of just transition and it's easy because you're now in the room. You are fully present.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I love your dress. That's a great audition dress too.
Thank you so much.
All right, Brennan.
Yes.
Hi.
Hello.
Do you have a joke for us?
I've been thinking about it ever since you said it, and it all left my brain.
Okay, that's all right. That's right. How about tell us once COVID happened, how did it make you, were you still in school? How did it make you feel? Did you feel rushed? Did you feel scared? Tell us about that.
It was really weird because so I was coming home for spring break, but then I just packed up my whole dorm and moved back. And it was weird because it's serious. And I mean, clearly school shut down and I was at home and we have all these masks and social distancing. And, but also the weather was beautiful those first 2 weeks of quarantine. And I was going on walks, seeing people. And it just was really surreal because it didn't feel like something as serious as it is, but clearly it is. And then it was weird not being around people. I'm such a people person. I regenerate off of other people. So being in day one in my room, I was this isn't for me. I can't do this. But yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good. Thank you for sharing those feelings. Thank you.
Yeah.
Y'all were wonderful.
Wonderful. Wonderful job, guys. You should feel really proud of yourselves. And I want to say this to you. This is some advice that someone gave to me, and I share it with anyone who is pursuing this career. Because we are always self-critical. We're always thinking about how we can do things better. And a lot of times, someone said it, we focus on the things that we didn't do. Make sure you always, always, always have the conversation with yourself. It's balance. What are the things that you did that you wanted to do? What are the things that you nailed? And what are the things that you want to work on? Not that you did bad or not that you didn't do, just what are the things that you want to work on? And then if you are in a place where you're focused on more of the challenges than the positives, give yourself a time limit. I'm going to give myself 2 minutes to think about this. I'm going to walk these 3 blocks and then I'm switching gears, right? There needs to be a cutoff point. Because you are going to audition more than you will ever work, probably. right? That process of auditioning. And I don't want you to get into the habit now of meditating or harping on the things that you need to work on. Sometimes you got to go, okay, I didn't quite hit that the way I wanted to. Well, what can you do better? Okay, great, great, great. Oh, it's been 5 minutes. What's next? What's next in the day? Am I going to the movies? Am I going to go hang out? Like, be able to tell yourself, okay, you've done that and now you're moving on. And I think that it just really helps you understand that it's not life or death. We're playing make-believe for a profession, and that's a gift, and that's a beautiful thing, and it's something that we should have fun doing. So even as we're working on ourselves, don't lose that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We can move on to questions. I know the performers may have questions too. But we'll follow your lead, Taylor.
All right, sounds good. Thank you, all of the performers, and thank you so much, Q and Lawrence, for your wonderful, wonderful feedback. It was a gift to all of us, so thank you so much. I think, a question that we like to start with, just to give people a look at your career paths, is can you both tell us a little bit about your career paths and journeys so that we can hear a little bit more about your stories?
Sure. We'll try to keep it short, too. Mm-hmm. Everybody's path is completely different. We have friends who study biology and have done 5 Broadway shows. We've had, people that became, studied dance and musical theater, but became doctors later on. Everybody's path is different. I'm from Omaha, Nebraska. I went to Brown L. Talbot and then North High School, UNO, and then I transferred to Ithaca College and got a BFA in musical theater. And then I moved to New York City right after I graduated, and I got an agent pretty about 2 or 3 years after I moved to New York, and I started touring right away. And my first show in New York was Fame off Broadway. And then I got an agent, and I toured most of my career, early in my career, for about, 6 or 7 years with different shows. I've done a lot of shows. I've seen all of the United States through doing shows and touring, international tours as well. And then I came back to New York and did Broadway. And now, if you don't know, we're married. We're best friends. And then we started dating, and now we're married with a kid. Go figure.
And my story was completely different from hers, and that's how it happens. If you don't mind, can I just to show mm-hmm. the juxtaposition? So like Q, she did everything that she said, but her first, I want to say her first audition ever in New York City was for a tour, and she booked it, right? So she came to New York, she kind of like fell into this audition. She was like, what are they doing over there? I'm going to go audition for that. And she's on tour with Gladys Knight. Like, that was her journey, right? Whereas like I went to undergrad, I went to graduate school. Graduate school was over, and I took a job doing a children's tour because I knew for me, it was gonna, the tour was for 3 months, and then I was gonna like be released. And I'm the kind of person that I'm like, it's better for me to jump in the deep end of the pool and figure out how to swim than it is for me to get in the shallow and kind of wade, out into the deep end. And there are other people who need to like wade in the shallow end and then swim out into the deep end. So once my tour was over, I kind of moved to New York City, no job, and a lot of dreams, And I hit the audition circuit, and I didn't have an agent. So I was going to open calls, and sometimes I wasn't seen, and I would be waiting all day. And sometimes I was. And the more I did that, the more the casting directors began to notice me, and they remembered, oh yeah, because the only thing that I can control was my audition. I didn't have an agent. I didn't have anything like that. So I was like, well, I know these 3 songs or whatever, and whenever they're appropriate, I'm gonna sing those and I'm gonna do the best. And after a while, the casting directors, they remember you. They're like, oh yeah, he sings that song. That's good. And then all of a sudden, I started getting called in, and then eventually, I got an agent. I actually left New York City. I feel like I'm talking a mile a minute, but I know we're trying to go fast. I left New York City really after 3 years feeling like I had failed. I was not on Broadway. Everybody that I knew around 7:30 would kind of disappear. And I was like waiting. And so I moved out to Los Angeles because I've always really wanted to do film and TV. And I started working out there. And then, of course, the moment I left New York was like, come on back. So then I had to go all the way back to New York. And that was my journey. So I kind of came to Broadway like 3 years later, being in the city, and the time is different for everyone. And if I could go back and talk to my younger self, I would say, don't compare your journey to anyone else's, you know, because your journey is your journey. It's gonna take as long as it's gonna take. And even though she booked her first jobs, she still spent a time in the city looking for jobs, right? Whereas I started off looking for jobs, you know, it's always an ebb and flow. So you've got to be willing to like take that journey.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. So we have a lot of questions from our attendees. So first off, can you just describe a little bit what the audition process is like?
Mm-hmm. And do you want to just like one of us take one question, you know, instead
of
both of us answering the question?
Yep.
We can decide who wants.
Go.
Great. You want to take
just the question. Sorry.
What is the audition process like?
It just depends on the show, but I'll talk about for Come From Away. I booked Come From Away through a video. I didn't audition in person. I much rather audition in person. Most auditions are done in person for theater. But most of the time, if you don't have an agent, you will go to something called an open call, where it's hundreds of people sometimes, and you just wait your turn. Sometimes they say prepare 16 bars. Sometimes they say prepare 8 bars. You wait all day, sometimes in the cold, sometimes in the rain. And you finally get your chance to go in and shine. You have to make those 8 bars count. And if they like you from there, or if they want to see more, you do something called a callback. Well, they'll call you back the following day or the next week, and they might have you dance or sing from the show. And they might have you do one more audition with the director or the choreographer. It just depends. And after all of that, sometimes you get a big old no. But for Come From Away, I auditioned on tape because I was in Arkansas. And I just kept putting different material on tape for about 3 or 4 days. And then I finally got cast. So that's that.
That's great. All right. So how do you create opportunities for yourself?
Yeah. There's many ways. I think the surefire way to create opportunities for yourself is to always be prepared. Always be prepared, because preparation plus opportunity equals success, right? So if you're prepared, then you wanna surround yourself with people and surround yourself with the business, right? So you should know, if you're living in New York City, where Actors Equity Building is, right? You should know how to go online to Playbill or Backstage or whatever, and just see like who's casting, what shows are coming to Broadway. You know, when Broadway opens back up, what shows are coming? Oh, I love that show. I think there's a role for me in that show. Let me start learning some music from that show, or music that fits that character in that show. Let me do that now, so that when the opportunity presents itself, or if the opportunity doesn't present itself, what if you're in the room auditioning for a play, right? But the director also directs musicals, right? So you create opportunities by showing up and being professional, by being prepared. My second show, Hair, that I did on Broadway, I got that job, I think, entirely because I was working with the director previously, and there was a cast switch. And she wanted people that she knew that would work hard, that were creative, and worked off their instincts. So I showed up and I was like, I know you just saw me in one decade, but like, I can also be in the 60s. But the relationship that we developed in the rehearsal room created the opportunity for me to join that cast. So I think preparation is the biggest way to seize the moment, because you never know when the moment or the introduction can come. And you can jump in, please, if you...
No, that's good.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And to kind of build off of that a little bit, what are some ways that you mentally or vocally prepare before you enter an audition room?
It starts before the audition. I guess that's what the question is. But it starts in life, right? You try to make habits, positive, healthy habits in your life. Try to stay healthy physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Some people meditate on a daily basis, do devotions on a daily basis, work out
Personally, I try to get to the gym 3 to 4 days a week, or I try to get some kind of physical exercise because everything is connected. When I'm breathing correctly through exercise, through a bit of sweat, and you're building stamina, you're working on your vocal control through your breath, it gives me so much oxygen to my brain so I can think clearer. Even if it's walking, speed walking, riding a bike, whatever, I do try to be physical. So I go swimming, I ride a bike, I take walks, I do something called the daily burn. It's these workouts every day. I just try to do something physical every day because that helps me think better and clearer. Vocally, you are your best vocal teacher, right? Listening to different styles of music. I'm not a big riffer. I'm not an R&B kind of a singer, but in order for me to be better, I try to listen to R&B music, pop music. Most of the time, I have no idea what these kids are saying on these songs. I have no idea, but I listen because your ear is key too to developing your sound. So listen to different genres that are sort of uncomfortable for you, listen to songs that you typically wouldn't sing. And just try to incorporate that into your book, into your library, to give you range, because you never know at an audition what you'll be asked to do.
And also it might change, you know, it will evolve as you evolve as an artist. So like for me, I know music is a big part of my life, and music helps me focus. And so, yes, this is my instrument. So warming up the body is like key to everything that I do. But also like in the audition, like when I'm there, music kind of helps drown out all the noise. You know, you might be sitting out in front of, you might be sitting outside the door, and you're just hearing singer after singer go in, and you know, it helps block all that out so I can focus on me. And sometimes I'm listening to the music that I'm gonna sing, and sometimes I'm listening to just other music to just center me. So find a process that just keeps you in that place of I'm enough, and I'm ready to like walk in here, and this is my offering to you, right? You are a solution to a casting problem. Never forget that. Mm-hmm. Every time you audition, you are a solution to a casting problem. They have to find these people, and you walk in the room going, I am your solution. Mm-hmm. You have the power.
Wow, I love that. I've never heard anything like that. You are the solution to the casting problem. That's great. That's fantastic.
It's true.
Yeah. So a couple more questions directly related to the audition process that are kind of fun. During an audition, how do you figure out how animated you should be?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question, more so for film as well, because I have that issue on film, because I come from theater. And in theater, you know, sometimes the gestures are a lot bigger, so you're animated. But as you get older, you become sort of more comfortable with your body, with who you are, right? Knowing that you are enough. I would never encourage someone to go into an audition room and say, okay, now it's time to be animated. You go into the audition room just as yourself. Mm-hmm. If they need more, they'll ask for more, right? Or the director or casting director will adjust you. But never go in there thinking I need to be animated. Go in there saying I'm going to tell this story of the monologue that you're talking about, that you're speaking on, or the song that you're singing. Just tell the story, and there's no need for animation.
I will also just add this short thing, because like as the performers were performing, you know, sometimes we don't know what to do with our hands, you know, and like we're like, what do I do? Tell the truth. That's how you solve that problem, right? Just tell the truth, and your body will do what it naturally does. When you are not auditioning, you are having conversations with people, you are telling stories, you are recounting feelings, and your body is doing its natural thing. But then sometimes when we get into the audition room, we feel like we need to do something else. Just tell the truth. And if it doesn't feel natural to you, don't do it. Because it's not truthful to you in that moment.
That's great. What is the quirkiest question you've been asked in an audition? And what was your answer?
Quirkiest question.
I was asked to tell a joke, and that's why I asked you, because I was like, what? I don't have no jokes. I'm trying to audition. And it just threw me. He was like, tell me a joke. And I was like, what? So that for me, that's why I'm like, have a joke, because what I realized is I was so focused on performing the audition like right and the way that I wanted to do that I stopped like existing as Lawrence. And I was kind of like, I'm audition Lawrence, like some other person. And so that kind of like threw me. So that was like the quirkiest thing for me.
I don't know really. It's not really a quirky question, but someone asked me if I could scat. I'm not a scatter in the least bit. and I was like, not really. And they're like, well, let me help you out a little bit. What does a trumpet sound like? And I was like, and that's what came out. And I was embarrassed. Everybody laughed. So yeah, that's that.
Those are great. How do you cope with the rejection following an audition? And then how do you stay motivated to keep auditioning then?
Mm-hmm. It's a great question, guys. I'm reading it. Okay. It is not easy to be rejected, and it does not get easier. You just kind of become numb to it. I remember being in the city early on, and I called my mother one day, and I was like, they're going to have to start telling me no in another language. Because the English version of no, like I've heard it so many times, I need it in Spanish, you can say it in Portuguese, whatever. And that was just my way of saying like, you're gonna hear no more than you will ever hear yes. It is not personal, but I say that and I also say it's hard not to take it personally because like you're the person that's putting yourself on the line, you're exposing yourself. What I can tell you is that you handle rejection the best that you can in the moment. And you never ever let someone's no convince you otherwise of what you know about yourself, which is that you are more than enough, mm-hmm. and you have everything it takes. Mm-hmm. And if you want it and you want to pursue it, you can make things happen. Like it just will happen. And so, you know, when you feel overwhelmed by the rejection, I believe that if you don't resist the feeling. If you let it happen naturally, then it'll dissipate a lot quicker than if you try to like strangle it down. Just live in the moment. I'm feeling rejected. What does that feel like? But then don't create a story. That's what I want to say. Don't create a narrative. You got to know, but go, okay, great. I got to know. Don't create the story up. I got to know because I'm not good enough. They don't like the way I look. They didn't like the way I sounded. They didn't like that's a narrative that is not true. So stop making up stories. Just deal with what happened. I got to know. Okay. Where's my next opportunity for a yes? And how do you stay motivated?
How do you stay motivated? Just working on yourself because everything is out of your control. The only thing that isn't in your control is this, right? Head to toe. That's the only thing. Sometimes you may not get cast because you're not the right height. Maybe the guy that they cast for the lead, maybe you are too short to play his opposite. You probably could out-sing, out-dance the girl who booked it, but for some reason she looked right. Her height was different. It's not it's your DNA. It's you can't help it, right? So just take control of this and this, right? And your body, right? Do feed your soul, feed your mind, feed your spirit, feed your body. Just take care of yourself. Take care of yourself.
Oh, and remember, everyone has that moment in their lives. All artists have that moment in their lives when they were like, I want to do that. Everybody has that, right? You watched something, you heard something, you saw something. It was a movie, it was a live show. It was something that lit a fire inside of you. Protect that, hold on to that. In the moments where you feel like, ugh, why am I doing this? Go back to that moment. Go back to that moment because that's when you became alive, right? That's when your artist was born and you need to take care of that. And so on those hard days or hard months or hard years, you know, tap into that moment where the artist in you came alive and protect that because that's what's gonna keep you going too.
That's great. Is technical dance experience completely necessary to make it in musical theater?
No, I don't think so.
It's not necessary, but it is important. I am not a dancer. I'm a mover and shaker. And in college, you have to take, you know, your ballet, tap and jazz, modern. I had to take all that for 5 years, right? I was in college for 5 years. It's very important because dance gets you in touch with your body, right? Everything is connected. It even helps you present monologues, right? And helps you with movement in your song. It's necessary if you want to perform, but it's not necessary to build a career on. I'm not a dancer and I'm okay with that, but I'm in touch with my body. Right. So I think it's important to take yoga, to do things physically, to keep control of your body and to understand its capabilities. But not knowing how to tap or not knowing how to do a batma I think you should know what those things are,
right?
But it's not necessary.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I was just saying, if you come from it, it doesn't exclude you from making it in musical theater,
right?
But it's definitely something that you should try to enhance. If you know you're not a strong mover, get in movement classes, because if you're a great singer, at some point they're gonna wanna see how in touch with your body are you, you know what I mean? And they might not put you in the front, but they might need you to be in the back doing 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, you know? And so just be in touch, but it doesn't exclude you.
That's great to know. Kind of changing gears a little bit and talking about right now and the current situation of our world. What are some ways that you are keeping creative from home?
Well, you should start with this one too. He's working on a project, but also we have a 4-month-old baby. I cannot believe we have a baby. That's the biggest project. He keeps us super duper duper busy. That's what we're really focused on, but I have some goals and stuff in my heart and head that I need to put out on paper. He's actually been doing it. He's been putting stuff on paper.
I mean, but here's the thing. This is a very tricky and crazy time, but it's also a gift from a different perspective, right? Artists, this is time for you to like dive in. Like, yes, it feels like we're sitting on the couch, but like if you're an actor and you want to perform, watching great performances, that's like you're doing homework, right? You're studying. That is something. Why did you believe him or her when they said that thing or sang that song? So like even just watching good movies, if you write, this is a time when you can, you know, sit down at your laptop, create a short story, turn it into a script, you know.
Yeah, give yourselves like 10 minutes. I'm gonna write. I have 10 minutes, I'm gonna write something.
Yep.
And write whatever comes out of your head. And then you never know what will evolve out of that.
Right.
Know?
Get on a Zoom meeting and have your friends or whatever, you know, and have your friends, you know, read a play, you know, just like read it, just like, you know, now you have the time. A lot of times we're like, I didn't have time to do that. Well, nobody has an excuse now. People have a lot of time right now. So like as an artist, use this time to fill yourself so that when the business starts back up, you're on full, not on empty.
Mm-hmm. Love that. So kind of building on that, we have, you know, a lot of our attendees and students, they, you know, are starting to get prepared for a career in professional theater. So how specifically can they use this time? And I know that you just said a few ways, but is there some things that they can be doing to, you know, individually look at themselves and get prepared, you know, to continue working towards a career in professional theater?
Yeah, you know, you have to know what you know and know what you don't know,
mm-hmm.
right? Know what you know and know what you know that you're talented. You know that you can hit a high C. You know that, but what I don't know about myself is that can I do a double pirouette? I don't know. Let me figure it out. Like this is the perfect time to figure out what you don't know. I don't know anything about Shakespeare. I don't know anything about Renaissance theater. I don't know anything about that. I may not ever do it. Oh, it's 7 o'clock. Yay!
Oh yeah, we do our
in New York, they cheer on the essential workers at 7 o'clock. The whole city is awesome.
Yeah.
We're gonna open a window so you can hear.
Yeah.
It's like it's an amazing coming together moment.
You can hear the people cheering. Yeah. Every day at 7 o'clock. Also, know what you want. You know, in this business, like there are so many things that you can do. Know what you want. Do you want to do musical theater? you might not. You might say, I don't even, like, I would rather not worry about my voice. I would rather do plays. So start with what you want, because then you can start a plan. For those that are watching that are going to be, you know, joining the audition ranks, you know, soon, you know, start to imagine your career. What do you want? And then set a plan to actually go get that. Yes, it would be great to have an agent, but you don't have to have an agent. If I don't know if you guys do showcases, and if you walk away from a showcase and you don't have representation, that's not a deal breaker by any means. That just means you're coming to the city without an agent. So you might have to work a little bit harder, but you are not farther behind someone who has an agent. And if you do have an agent, it doesn't mean that you get to relax and go, well, I got an agent, I don't have to do anything. Because because the person that doesn't have an agent is going to be running 100 miles an hour, and you might be running at 75, and they're going to pass you. So, like, have a plan to get what you want. I think that that's a really good thing that you can do right now while everything is kind of like on pause.
Fantastic. Is it okay if we have three more questions? Is that okay that we continue moving forward? Yep. I know that we just reached seven. Okay. We have one of our attendees who's a high school senior, and it's been a really tough time having performances, graduation, prom, and all of those, you know, really, you know, milestone moments in high school. They're canceled. So they want to know, what is a specific piece of music or theater that keeps you optimistic?
That is a very... I know, right?
For me, Carolina Change. Like, there is something about that story, that those performances, it just speaks to me. It's about human redemption. It's about people coming together, a lot like, you know, Come From Away. But that just inspires me, and it keeps me, I don't know, it just does something for my spirit. I love it.
Yeah, I would say Come From Away. I'm looking forward to going back, but it inspires me to, it gives me hope. You know what I mean? There's so much hope in the show. The theme of the show is all about community hope, selflessness. And it's what we need right now. And I haven't been to work since October because I was on maternity leave. So I'm really looking forward to telling that story again. So the music, if you haven't listened to the soundtrack of Come From Away or seen it, I encourage you to do that during this time. It's beautiful.
And if you're not celebrated by walking across the stage, know that you're celebrated by the people that it matters the most to, your parents, your family, like, and yourself. Right?
Yeah.
You know, yes, everyone wants a graduation. And there are some people who opt not to go to graduations. And I know it's tricky because there are so many things that are not happening this year or kind of just being skipped over. But I think the biggest thing in life is to consider perspective, right? And you might not get to walk across the stage, but hopefully you're healthy, your family is healthy, and now you can pursue this career. You still got that diploma. You know what I mean? And listen, this is 2020. Have a graduation party virtually if you just need to, like, have that thing. So don't focus too much on what's not happening as best you can. It sucks, though, and I want to acknowledge that for those of you who didn't get to have a prom or, you know, all of these things that, like, are part of, like, a rites of passage, right? But it's not the end of the world, and you've got so much life ahead of you, and you're going to have so many wonderful things happen.
That was beautiful advice. Thank you both.
Yeah.
So what advice can you give to a young person hoping to move to New York City and begin auditioning?
Don't wait. Just do it. You only have one life to live. People are so afraid of New York. It is a big city. It's a small city with just a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
Don't be afraid. If you get here, just know that everybody is just like you. Everybody is, you know, scared too. Everybody just moved here too. Because the idea is when you go to these auditions and stuff, you look around, you're like, oh my God, these people have been here forever. They're so talented. But they're probably looking around too, saying, oh my God, these people are so talented. They've been here forever. We're all in the same boat. I'd say just do it and don't wait too long.
That's the best advice.
You can always go home. Home will always be there. I can always come home to Nebraska. I can always go home.
You'll never have enough money. You'll never feel
right
confident enough.
Right.
It just won't happen. So run in the direction of your fear.
Just do it. Just do it.
That's fantastic. And then our last question that we have, I thought this was kind of a great question to end on because it's something that all of our attendees and student performers can think about is, you know, how do you advocate for yourself?
How do you advocate for yourself? Well, I'll use this example for Mary Poppins. I'll use it, you know, creatively. I'll answer this question in a creative way. I, again, know that you are enough, right? Know what you can do, yep. Know what you can't do.
Yep.
But for Mary Poppins, there was a role, I was cast in the tour, I played Mrs. Corey, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, but when I saw the show, there was this role that I really wanted of Miss Andrew, and she was typically an older woman, probably in her 50s, she's typically cast very slim, you know, white, and a character actress. And I was like, I would love to do that role one day. But in that little lion demon in the back of my head was just like, no, you're not good enough. You're not skinny enough. You're not white, basically. But I kept thinking about it. I kept praying about it. And I'm like, you know what? I am good enough. I'm just going to try. The worst they can do is say no. So I tried to audition for the understudy role. They let me audition. And to make a long story short, I ended up booking it. And then I closed the show on Broadway as the role of Miss Andrew, the first Black woman to ever have a leading role in the history of Mary Poppins, the movie and the show itself. But there's nobody that will believe in you as much as you and your family, right? You have to believe in you. You have to know what you can do and know what you can't do.
Yes.
But stand up for yourself. Stand up for yourself and believe in yourself.
And she said it. How do you advocate for yourself? The first thing she said was you have to know you, right? I can't advocate for me unless I know who I'm. So Q knew I am able to do this role. No, I do not look traditionally like the people that they cast in the role, but I know I can do this role. Then she prepared herself and then she asked for an audition, right? And so then it's like, okay, you can have the audition. You're nothing like what we usually cast, but she was prepared and she was on it. And then they go, oh, well, I've never seen it like that before, right? So you can't just advocate for yourself and not be prepared. You have to know, or you can't advocate for yourself for something that you know that you're not ready to do, right? Mm-hmm. So first start off with what you know about yourself and what you're capable of, and then don't be afraid. The worst you can hear is no, and you're already hearing that, you know, from so many different ways. So that's the worst. If that's the worst they can say is no, then I'll ask.
I love it. Thank you both so much. We are out of time. Unfortunately, this was such an amazing class. Thank you to Q and Lawrence. It was just a joy having you both here, and the feedback that you gave and the answers you gave were just so wonderful. So thank you. And thank you to all the performers, the student performers as well. You were all fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you guys for all the participants and thank you for joining today's workshop. So listen, if you want to check out any more of these kind of digital offerings and learn more about how you can support Omaha Performing Arts mission, you can go to their website, OPA's website at www.opa.org/online. And remember, the show must and will go on. This is just an interlude, okay? We look forward to seeing all of you back very soon, both me and Q and everyone at the Omaha Performing Arts staff.
Stay safe and stay healthy and stay creative.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you so much.